Welcome back to our community. Susie Thomas visiting with State Representative Christina Hagen. You're running for Congress?
Yes, Susie. So I have been running for Congress since April of this year. So it has been a different experience. We're working hard at it every single day. My husband and my family have been so amazing and so gracious and helpful and supportive in power and prayer and also in their words and deeds and allowing me and helping to come around me so that I can take on this voyage. I mean, this is certainly like a David and Goliath type circumstance in our race.
Yes. Well, what interests you now in taking what you've learned at this point to the national level?
Yeah, so I think this is a unique time. Love or hate President Donald Trump, he has served as a wrecking ball into what I believe is all that is wrong with American politics. And he's broken down the barrier for outsiders to be able to come in and restore their government, in my opinion. And, you know, whether the people believed in Bernie Sanders or Donald Trump to accomplish that, it was the same movement that people were so sick and tired of the gridlock and the dishonesty and the self-seeking service and the people serving the, you know, the most elite special interests and forgetting the American people. And I believe as somebody who waited tables for 15 years, grew up in our family business, our apartment above our small family business, went along on service calls with my mom and dad. I mean, we were in people's homes, in people's basements, waiting tables. I was, you know, there at the table learning about what people were thinking all through the years. And it's so time that we had servant leadership in our federal government. And although, you know, Donald Trump has a few more zeros after his income than I do, I think that we both know and understand what policies will positively impact the middle class. And that has been so long forgotten. And so I think this is the unique opportunity for me to go serve on the federal landscape and really be a fighter for American working people and also for our future, because right now we're spinning out of control in debt. We have $20 trillion in debt, $60 trillion in owed services. We have $60 trillion in interest on those owed services. And even if we cut every single entitlement program, we would still be in debt. Even if we, you know, taxed every dollar of the top 1% earners in this nation, we would still be in debt. So something has to change. And I believe as a young legislator, a conservative fiscal and social legislator, I'm willing to go in and make those tough decisions where, you know, I remember even when we had the deficit in the state of Ohio, we had an $8 billion deficit, 17% of our budget was missing. I remember looking around and a lot of people didn't want to take the tough votes. They didn't want to make the cuts that were necessary to get us back on track financially. And I never had any delay. I was excited to do what I believe our party stands for, because I think when we limit government, we restore power to the people. And that's what needs to happen today. That's what needs to happen tomorrow. And we might be able to hand something down to our children.
And as just like a normal old Joe sitting on the side here, let me just say we would love to see people at the national level be able to get along together and move forward together from two different perspectives, two different party perspectives, move us in the right direction, move us in a direction rather than just try to be the roadblock for the other, because things get done at the local level. Things get done that help the people who live there. And we'd love to see that taken to the national level. I'm sure it can be done. You've got so many cool bills going right now. And of course, the one personally close to my heart would be that heartbeat bill. Can you tell us where that stands and what's happening with that right now?
Yes. So the heartbeat bill is ever in a position of overcoming obstacles. But I knew that when God laid it on my heart that this was not going to be a battle won in 1 year or 2 years or even maybe 5 years. We're now in almost year seven of fighting for children with beating hearts. But I take great faith in knowing that partial birth abortion was legal in this nation. And it took state after state attempting to ban partial birth abortion, a really, really terrible process. And finally, it was banned by the courts, but it was Ohio that triggered that federal review. And so I believe Ohio can be that catalyst. We just have to get it across the finish line. And people look at me like I'm crazy because Governor Kasich vetoed it. But anybody who knows the political climate in Ohio, right now is not Governor Kasich's shining moment with the Republican Party. And even though he vetoed it in the last General Assembly, that does not mean that the legislature is unwilling to exude our strength in numbers and protect children with beating hearts and override a veto. So we certainly have a little ways to go here. We still need to get it through the House and the Senate. I suspect that the governor will take a very similar action and likely consistently veto it as he did last time. But that gives us an opportunity as members and representatives and the people who passed it wholeheartedly out of both chambers to overwhelmingly take back that right to support that measure and exercise our veto override power. So I believe that is the path to victory, and that is the trajectory that we are currently on.
Let's remind everybody what it says. What does the heartbeat bill say?
The heartbeat bill is extremely straightforward. It simply says that a child's life cannot be terminated upon the detection of a fetal heartbeat. So when you hear that little heart beating, we simply can no longer stop it. Mm-hmm. It's very straightforward. It does protect the life of the mother if there is a medical circumstance in which she is not going to be able to make it through the pregnancy. And we value both lives in that circumstance. Yes. But certainly we know and understand that a child is separate, unique, distinct, that their DNA is powerful and viable and certainly their own. And so there's no greater indicator of life than a beating heart. You know, when my brothers as paramedics or EMTs or my husband as an EMT arrive at a scene and somebody's near death, they check their pulse to make sure they're alive. So if that's an end of life indication of life or death, it should be a beginning of life indication that the state is willing to protect and the courts are willing to uphold the constitutional rights to that child in that circumstance. And it's a more certain marker of viability than any other standard that we've ever passed into law. And that's why it's so important to challenge the courts in this way, because we do this anecdotal thing where we choose dates and weeks and times in the pregnancy. But per the court ruling, the marker of viability is really the one that is of utmost important discussion with the courts. And because a heartbeat is a unique and distinct marker of viability, according to the courts, mm-hmm. that opens the gate wide open to have this conversation on Roe v. Wade.
I would think it would be more and more difficult to defend abortion when you have babies born at 22 weeks now, and that what used to be not considered viable. Now, these babies are not just surviving, but then thriving. And high-profile babies like J.R. Smith, when you look at his little baby and how they sadly and tragically announced that it was born at such a young age, at only 22 weeks gestation, and then to see how that baby is doing now is just heartening, isn't it? And I don't mean that as a pun, but that's got to be so encouraging. And then on the pro-life movement, it says a lot. It goes a long way towards saying a lot, does it not?
Yes, yes. And I mean, the American people are with us. Susie, I've been voted into office overwhelmingly. And even though I'm a great fiscal conservative, I really believe it's because people know I stand for the most vulnerable. Mm-hmm. And that matters to Democrats and that matters to Republicans. And unfortunately, a lot of people aren't willing to take the stand, but these little guys and gals have no one else who's going to go to bat for them, for their little beating hearts. And in most cases, the mothers don't know any different. And unfortunately, you know, until you have the knowledge, you don't have the power. And I can't tell you how many women have come to my desk and cried to me that when they had their planned pregnancy, their intended pregnancy, and they heard the heartbeat, mm-hmm. and they, you know, thought about the time frame, they realized that they had aborted a child with a beating heart, and they didn't know. You know,
right.
They've been sold this bag of goods that this is nothing. This is a cluster of cells. It's not a human being. And just last night on social media, I saw somebody share an image of their child. It was a miscarriage at 11 weeks, and the little beautiful baby was perfectly intact. Little hands, little feet, little body, face, eyes, ears, nose. I mean, if we just study science, You know, forget religion, forget all of this emotional warfare. Just study the medical science behind the distinct, unique DNA that's created in this process. I mean, who are we as the most civilized nation on earth to ignore these facts? I mean, it's just, it's amazing to me, but we see so many eyes and so many hearts open. And that's why I say the Fetal Heartbeat Protection Act, the debate alone is worth the heartache that the opposition causes to me and to the people who believe in it, because almost always, almost every single time somebody comes to me and they say, I didn't know until I heard this testimony. I didn't know until I read that headline in the paper. And it changes hearts and it saves lives.
Mm-hmm. I'm convinced generations from now, people will look back at this and go, how could that ever have been legal? The way we look back at slavery and say, how could that ever been permitted to continue?
Well, that's exactly right. And you know what, Susie, so many people say, well, this is the law of the land. You know,
so
Roe v. Wade has been decided, you know, and I say, well, so was Dred v. Scott.
Yes.
You know, should we have left a really bad ruling by the courts to be the law of the land? I mean, have we not grown? Have we not evolved in our thinking, our understanding? You know, has medical science not grown by leaps and bounds for us to know and understand how to serve these people, regardless of age or gestation? I mean, it's amazing.
It is. It's
really
almost
amazing.
Like it's kind of like being against a person's age, basically. It's age discrimination. You know?
In the worst possible way, yes.
What can we do to help promote that? What can we do as far as, well, any legislation that we want to get behind, but particularly this heartbeat bill today?
Yes. So this bill, I always ask for prayers for all legislators, that people would feel convicted to stand for what they believe is true and right, and that they would, you know, forget the banners on either side of the party, pro-choice or pro-life, and really just delve into what we are doing for our humanity. But second, you know, write letters, call your representative, call your senator, let them know how important this is to you and how meaningful it is to our culture of life. I mean, we wonder why our families are falling apart, why our social culture is falling apart. When we don't value the most vulnerable members of our society, how can we respect and value one another? How can we respect the family unit? I would just, you know, ask you to call, to write, to email. And if you feel strongly and you have a medical background, if you have a pastoral background, if you've been harmed by abortion, if you have carried, you know, multiple children, if you have had a child with a fetal anomaly, if you, you know, whatever your circumstances or your story is, never underestimate how incredibly powerful your testimony can be, and provide it to the House of Representatives or to the Ohio Senate. When you speak to us as legislators, we're there to represent you, and you can't ever underestimate the value that your voice brings to the process. So if a bill like this is moving and you have a powerful testimony that you believe can make a difference one way or the other, always, always call your legislator and ask to participate and give testimony, either written or physically be present, and you can change the outcome of a bill. I mean, it's very real. This is why we're there.
Awesome. State Representative Christina Hagen, thank you for everything you're doing in our community.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Susie.